just click on it to see what the love was all about. The love is that Jesus is here and wants to speak with us and start to speak with us. So with open hearts and minds, let us respond to God. Keep our appointment down. Down at the altar, you promised you would lead me. Down at the altar,
I give it to you.
God would come to you in a heap of emotions, joy and pain, sunshine and rain, bewilderment, excitement, confusion, and distraught pity. Asking you to meet us exactly where we are and see us to the next place that you would have us to be. God, we come to you confessing that it's not always been easy to follow your commandments. We come to you confessing that it's not always been easy to do the right thing. We come to you confessing that it's not always been easy for us to love our neighbor as ourselves. It's not easy to even love our enemies. Because of that difficulty, God, we come to you in spirit, asking you to forgive us. A spirit of repentance that shifts us and moves us and takes us to places that will turn us away from our sin and toward you, God. That's the cry of our hearts today. The cry of our hearts is that our minds and our hearts, our hands and our feet, our entire body would move 180 totally away from those things that separate us from you and that separate us from each other. And turn toward you. So our faces towards the sun. And so we hear our prayers of forgiveness in this time. His faithful to complete it. gatherings of saints, whenever what's going on in your life, if you honestly believed it and said it and thought it, you are forgiven. You are forgiven by the master forgiver. Now, how much you love, would you extend that same forgiveness, that same repentance? Would you extend that to the other, on the other side, in the other way? Believe this good news. Unlimited peace. And so now is the time to share the peace of Christ all around the world. We're asking that you share it with your people that you're in proximity with, if you happen to be in proximity to someone. If you're not, would you also put it online and tell us where you are and share that peace? Shout out to Sam and Oscar up there. Shout out to the worship team. God bless you. Peace of Christ be with you. Peace, love, and happiness. Shout out to Pastor, First Brother. You can't just keep thinking of. Listen, the church made up a whole bunch of stuff. And so I made it up. Let's continue in worship. Thank you.
Thank you. Jesus, 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 Jes
forever lost when do you listen to the song?
Thank you. to the house of the Lord. Amen. It is good and it is right for us to be together. Always together, be it in person, a few of us, or together by means of social media and the platform that has allowed us to continue to worship as many far and near. Thank God for that. We are so blessed to be able to come into the house of the Lord, to be able to call upon the name of the Lord without fear of persecution. Harm coming upon us, for we know that in this world there are many who today must monitor their words, their thoughts, and their actions pertaining to their faith because of persecution. And so we want to certainly be mindful of that, prayerful of that, and grateful for our place and station. So a thing happened yesterday, and I don't necessarily feel it is always appropriate for me to use this platform to speak to such things, but I just want to say a thing happened yesterday for which many have come to rejoice, and at the same time, many have come to lament. We want to hold space for all of those emotions at this time. I myself would say that I've been delighted this morning and yesterday in my perusing the pages of my friends, particularly two examples, both of them including girls who happen to be mixed race, biracial, who looked at the television screen and saw our future vice president and said, "Mom, you didn't tell me she looked like me." So I'm just rejoicing at that. Today, as we continue to walk forward, we know that our assignment does not change. We continue to be people of God, children of God, on mission of God. So before we turn our eyes and our hearts to the Word, let us enter into our congregation of prayer. Who is God except our Lord? There is none like you, O God, none so faithful and so true, none so loving and so kind, none so giving and so forgiving. And we, your people, say thank you. Thank you, God, for the privilege to call upon your name, knowing that when we do so in the name of Jesus, our beloved one, that you do hear us. And so, God, we pray for all of those whose names have already been called from the prayer list. We thank you for the work you continue to do in Casey's life and in his body, healing and restoring. May he quickly be back, even better than any place he's been before. For Eva's brother, God, we continue to pray for him, for his restoration, for visitation with yourself, that might bring comfort and healing to his body, wherever he might be. We pray for those who are laboring in hospitals and at home, wrestling with this virus, this plague that has visited us way too long from our perspective. God, would you grant healing? Would you grant good care? Would you grant hope? And would you grant peace for those who must close their eyes on this side of eternity to wake up in your arms? Would you give them peace? Would you give their family peace? Oh God, to believe beyond what we actually see. We thank you, God, for the privilege to be part of your church. Oh God, may our light never go out. May our salt never lose its savor. May we always look to you and long with all of our hearts and all of our actions and all of our words to be faithful witnesses to you, that you might trust us in this life to bear your name, to bear your reputation, and to make known in the earth who you are in truth. God, we pray for those around the world, for the persecuted church, for those who dare to say the name of the Lord in difficult places. Would you visit them where they are, God? Would you, Lord, would you be a light? Would you be life? Would you be a way, God, for them? God, would you also bring salvation because of their sacrifice to those who might see police working, to those who might be visiting violence upon them? Would you bring salvation to those? In order that the sacrifice of the martyrs and of the persecuted church would not be in vain. We come before you also, God, on behalf of 153 million orphan children in this world. Come, Lord Jesus, come quickly. Forgive us. For we know that the lingering of millions of orphans say that you don't take care of your own. So God, stir in the hearts of your people, O God, for tenderness. That we might set aside our own delight and agenda and attend to the most vulnerable in the world. O God, bring provision. Oh God, bring loving families. Oh God, bring supportive communities. Oh God, for the sake of those who cry, who long, who need, and who wait. Have your way in us, oh God. We are your people. We lead. We follow. And as we follow Great Word of Life, we ask you to open yourself to us now. So when we look, we will see, and when we listen, we will hear, because we don't want to be those who just see and hear. Let our hearts be transformed by the power of your truth. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be found acceptable in your sight, for you are a rock and our redeemer. And all God's people said, amen. Amen. Thank God. The word of the Lord comes to us this morning from the Apostle Paul's letter to the Thessalonians, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. And you know that it is our custom to stand as a way of showing respect for the word of God. So if you can and will, where you are, please stand in body and or in spirit. As we turn our attention to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. New to the biblical text, it's going to be toward the back of your Bible. 1 Thessalonians 5, beginning with verse 1, hear the word of the Lord. Now concerning the times and the seasons, brothers and sisters, you do not need to have anything written to you. For you yourselves know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. When they say there is peace and security, then sudden destruction will come upon them. Labor pains comes upon pregnant women. And there will be no escape, but you, beloved, are not in darkness for that day to surprise you like a thief. For you are all children of light and children of the day. We are not of the night or of darkness. So then, let us not fall asleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. For those who sleep at night, and those who are drunk and drunk at night. Since we belong to the day, let us be sober and put on the breastplate of faith and love, and for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has destined us not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. So I've been dwelling in this letter for this entire week as it has come to us from the lectionary. And I was inspired to write my own letter, pastoral letter, to Mamily. So here goes, dear Mamily, I thank God for you every time I think of you. Because of your extended sharing of the peace and your commitment to be together, always together, for the glory of God. It is good for us to embrace each other in these times. We have taken the high road when the low road was accessible. We have held on to hope amidst a pandemic that has threatened our very lives. While other pastors have had to fight to keep people safe on Sunday morning, you have been agile and trusting of the processes and decisions made, knowing they are for the good of all of us. You have offered your children as vessels of God's glory to be shared by the family. They are becoming freedom fighters, allies, and overall useful for justice, mercy, and humility. The oldest of you have weathered many storms and submitted to many changes to remain centered, called, and committed, even while your friends have departed and your children have wondered why you are still at this church. You have loved us still. So on this month, after Pastor's Appreciation Month, I want to express my appreciation for the family. A safe place to think and grow, a church not afraid to call for shalom and do the work that is necessary to bring it forth. I am proud to be a pastor here in this place where we belong to the day. We belong to the day. That's what the Apostle Paul is saying here. He reminds the church at Thessalonica. In this letter, his primary goal is simply encourage the church. Here, a mix of Greeks and Jews and Christ followers gather together around these few pages from their pastor. If, since we read, we belong to the day, let us be sober, putting on faith and love as a breastplate and the hope of salvation. So, even as they read, we read these ancient words today for a contemporary church. We belong to the day. The day. The day is the place where we are aware of what's going on. The day, nothing is hidden. In the day, it is the place where all of the mysteries of God that humans can understand and that God can expose are laid bare. The truth lives in the day. We belong to it. We belong to the day. As much as we probably want to sit with that and relish it and plaster it on the front pages of our social media pages, there's more. See, the word of the Lord calls us today to not just post, to not just secure truth and to relish it for ourselves, but to share these pages with others, especially those who may have forgotten that they too belong to the day. It's easy to forget, you know. It's easy to slip into the thoughts and pictures that represent the night. we've seen it in this election season. Maybe like we haven't seen it before. People who belong to the day stooping to use words and phrases and actions and motives that belong to the night to discredit and to disparage and to cast a shadow on those who belong to the day. But we know who we are. And I believe that God is calling us in this moment to hold up the fifth page of this letter and let all dwell in the night know that you, sister, brother, friend, belong to the King. As we do, we must protect our heart, our motives, our intentions, our volition, our mind, our heart. And we must put on faith and love, says Pastor Paul, as a breastplate, as a protection of our vision, protecting our will, protecting our emotions. Put on faith. You know, faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen, for by it people of old received their commendation. By faith we understand that the universe was created, word of God, so that what is seen was not made of things that are visible. By faith, Hebrews tells us, Abel offered to God a more acceptable sacrifice than Cain, through which he was commended as righteous, God commending him by accepting his gift. And through his faith, though he died, he still speaks. By faith, Enoch was taken up so that he could not see death, and he was not found because God had taken him up. Now, before he was taken, he was commended as having pleased God. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. So whoever would draw near to God must believe he exists and that he rewards those who seek him by faith. Noah, being warned by God concerning events as yet unseen, in reverent fear, constructed an ark for the saving of his household. By this, he condemned the world and became an heir of the righteousness that comes by faith. The faith of Abel, the faith of Noah, the faith of Abraham, of Israel, the faith of many who have gone before us. We must guard our hearts in faith as we proclaim, you are, you belong to the day. The faith of 18th century poet Phyllis Wheatley was mercy brought me from my pagan land, taught my benighted soul to understand that there's a God, that there's a Savior too. Once I redemption you sought nor knew, some view our sable race with scornful eye. Their color is a diabolical dye. Remember, Christians, Negroes, black as Cain, need to refine and join the angelic train. Phyllis Wheatley speaking into the darkness, calling those who dwell there into the day by faith. God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, that third stanza of that historic poem, song, the Negro National Anthem, calling us to remember who we are by faith. We belong to the day. Of our weary years, of our silent tears, who has brought us this far on our way. God, who is by thy might, lead us into the light, into the day. Keep us forever. We pray, sisters and brothers, it is not time for us to simply relish in the day, but work while it is day, for when night comes, no one shall work. Work out, yes, work out. We must relentlessly, like the Apostle Paul, make known to our sisters and our brothers, despite our past differences, despite our present disconnect, we belong to the... and word, when a word of destruction or hate is spoken, excuse me, we belong to the day. When we want to strike out in pettiness, reminding we belong to the day, when our neighbors, our friends, even family fold their arms and tighten their gaze gently, firmly, in faith, reminding them we belong. We friend on Facebook who recognized something I posted and made a comment asking me a question. That may even probably say it was politically charged. And I responded to her and I said, well, you know, but I'll DM you and have a conversation offline. And I DM you, and then after sitting with this text, I sent her an email and I said, I'm going to have this conversation with you if in fact we can agree that we both belong. I'm happy to have this conversation with you. If you're willing to agree that I might learn something from you, you might learn something from me, and we still might disagree. If we can do that, then we can proceed and have a conversation. This is just my way of trying to remind myself and somebody else that in spite of our differences, we followers, believers in Jesus Christ, and then once we've done that, we can let our faith take over. They might not want, somebody might not want to hear it. They may mock, they may ignore. But that's when faith does her best work. As Phyllis Wheatley, as James Weldon Johnson, as the composers and performers of this anthem, let the breastplate of faith protect our heart, our intentions, that our message will permeate when we say, you belong to the team. We belong to the king. We're not just faith as a guard over our heart, but also faith. We, like the Apostle Paul to the church, must make known that love is the greatest virtue. Not service, not issues, not position, but love. We belong to the king where love is true, virtuous, and we must remind ourselves and those who belong to the day to love. I was talking to a brother this past week, and he was telling me about a time he was incarcerated, and he knew he was guilty of his crimes, and he was sharing with me how, you know, this was not his first time, and he had gone in and come out, and he said, you know, that's the crime, I had never repented of my sin. And even though I got out, I just kept trying to walk forward, but I had never really done my business with God, he said. But, you know, this last time, I knew that I was facing 30-some-odd years. As a man in his late 50s, I was facing 30-some-odd years, and I was sitting with my court-appointed attorney, and we were discussing the facts as we could see it. And then he said this, he said, I asked my attorney, are you a believer? She said, what? He said, I'm a believer in Jesus Christ, and I'm just asking you, are you a believer? And she said, well, nobody's ever asked me that before, but yes, I am. Yes, I am. And he asked her this. He said, I'm a believer. If you're a believer, are you going to defend me like I'm your brother? This was just his way of saying, we belong to the day, the same day, the same light. And he said that she represented him like he was a paid customer. By God's grace and God's glory, he had the opportunity to remind her, we belong to the day. We're not trying to remind people what they did wrong or what they forgot, what the errors or faults were, or who won and who lost. But we belong to the day, and we need to remind all those we know. Even if we speak with tongues of people and of angels, if we do not have love, we are only making noise. And if we have the gift of prophecy that can fathom all mystery and all knowledge, and have all faith that can move mountains, but do not have love, it's nothing. And if we give all we have, the poor, and even give order that we might boast about it. But do not have loves, retain nothing. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not self-anger. It keeps no record of wrong. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love is the highest value, the richest expression, and the most important thing to God, who declares the greatest commandments are to love God and love your neighbor as yourself. It is the most excellent way for we who belong to the King. And so let love of God and love of each other, love of ourselves, guard our hearts as we make it known you belong to the day. And not just faith and love as a breastplate, but also, the Apostle Paul says, hope. Put on hope as a helmet for salvation. Let's be clear, we cannot save anyone. We cannot save ourselves for that matter. It is by grace alone, through faith in Jesus Christ, that we are saved from ourselves, from our sins, from the fruit of the flesh, from the lies of the enemy, and ultimately from death in this world. This is our blessed hope, and this is the hope we must make known, friends, in the earth, in order that someone who does not belong to the day might leave the treachery and deception of the night to stand in the light of day. How will they know if we don't tell them? We cannot just hope for the salvation of those in the night. We can't just hope for salvation for our friends and our loved ones and our strangers. We must tell of the day to which we belong with hope. None of this makes sense without hope. God turned man and God. And so when God comes to earth, so we hope. Conquered sin, life, and death, we must hope. Lives and reigns, and so we hope. We are seated in heavenly places with Christ. It doesn't make sense. What we will be, we don't know. But what we know is that when he appears, we will be like him. And so we hope in Christ that all who belong to the day might put to death the deeds of the night and stand together in the light. Gracious God, we thank you for the gift of your word, for the manifestation of your spirit. Would you break the bricks, concrete from our hearts, that you might find a heart of flesh conducive to the seed of your word, that it might ground deep, like a tree planted by rivers of water that will bring forth fruit in its season. Fruit with seed in it, fruit that will last, fruit of glory, which is for all of our good. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Spirit, world without end, and all God's people say, amen.
I love Judah. I'm going to go to the hospital. Thank you.